Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendu Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So as you know that these lectures are basically based on the current affairs, right, which are very important part of your preparation for the civil services examination, right, which is conducted by the UPSC. Okay, and for that you must also read the national newspapers like the Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers. Apart from that, you can also supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. These lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. For that, you can subscribe to the channel on the YouTube, that is Future IAS, right? And there you will get the daily current affairs based lectures online. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is all about Ebola. So Ebola was basically an epidemic that basically engulfed some of the countries, specifically the Democratic Republic of Congo, right, which is basically lying in Africa last year, right? In 2018-2020, that was basically the cases that was spiked in the Congo specifically and killed, right, thousands of the people, right? So it was an epidemic that was basically related to that. Now, this similar epidemic, right, which was there in 2018-2020, now the similar epidemic, right, was also some of the few cases were also recorded in the Congo, right? So in certain provinces, or specifically in the eastern provinces of the Congo, specifically in the northern Kivu, which is also the eastern province of the you know, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, have recorded, right, some infections related to the Ebola. Okay, now the news basically is flashing related to the Congo has recently been declared that the infections which were there, right, or the 12 people which was infected because of Ebola, now they have been controlled, right? So the Congo has declared that the Ebola outbreak have been completely stopped, right? It was ended, right? And the infected 12 people which was there, right, out of 12 people, 6 of them have already been killed, and this outbreak have now been controlled. Okay, so this outbreak, or this time outbreak, was basically controlled with the help of a vaccine which is made by the Merck, right? So the Merck Ebola vaccine, which is also the only vaccine which is available, right, to control your Ebola, now have been given to more than 1600 patients. Right, these patients which were basically suspected of having this Ebola virus, and that was the reason this Ebola outbreak again was basically controlled in the Democratic Republic of Congo. Okay, now these cases which were related to now this outbreak was also linked to 2018-2020, the Ebola epidemic that was also killed more than 2,200 people, as officially recorded by the Democratic Republic of Congo, right, which is also the second highest toll recorded in the disease state. Okay, when we are talking in terms of Ebola, so now let us understand the 2-3 terms that are here. First of all, what is outbreak? That thing that is coming to your mind. What is epidemic? And let's understand one more term called pandemic. Okay, because the pandemic, just now you have the corona, right, or the novel coronavirus. So what is epidemic? What is epidemic? So first let us understand epidemic. So for example, the Ebola was basically an epidemic in 2018-2020. So simply you can say that an epidemic is a disease that affect a large number of people within a community or within a population or within a region. That means its spatial spread is limited to a region, limited to a community, or limited to a population. That is called epidemic. Okay, clear? Now, what is pandemic? For example, novel coronavirus and the COVID is basically a pandemic disease. Now, what is this pandemic? Pandemic is an epidemic that spread over the multiple countries or continents. It's very simple. The pandemic is also an epidemic, but that is basically spread over the multiple countries, multiple continents and networks, right? So simply, if you have the spatial distribution or a spatial right, the finding of the cases across the continents, across the countries, that makes the particular epidemic as a pandemic. Now, what is outbreak? What is outbreak that is basically there recently in Democratic Republic of Congo? So simply outbreak, you can say outbreak is a greater than anticipated increase in the number of the endemic cases. Okay, so it's a greater than anticipated. What we anticipate, it was greater than that number of cases that is basically related to the endemic cases. Now you can say that it can also be a single case in a new era, or it is not a quickly controlled, or outbreak can become an epidemic. So that is the case. That is the case. You should control that outbreak, otherwise it can also convert into epidemic, or if not controlled, it can also convert into the pandemic. So outbreak, you can say, is the initial stage, right, where you have greater than anticipated increase in the number of cases. If not controlled, it can convert into epidemic. An epidemic, if not controlled, it can convert into a pandemic. Okay, so that is the just definition for that. Okay, now important information about the Ebola. So Ebola is basically also known as the Ebola virus disease, which is also known as EVD, which is also known as Ebola hemorrhagic fever, right? And its fatality rate is very high. So it is often fatal illness in the human beings. Okay, and which basically include the three genus or three genera the virus or the Ebola virus basically belongs to. The first is basically the Suve virus, second is Marburg virus, third is basically Ebola virus. Now what we are talking about, the Ebola virus is basically, right, it basically belongs to this genus of Ebola virus. Now there are five species within that genus that have been identified within genus of Ebola virus. They are Zaire, right, Bundi Bogia, then Sudan, then Restone and Tai Forest. These are the five species that have been identified by basically by the scientists or by the doctors, right? Here, the what is the mode of transmission of this Ebola virus? So first of all, the virus called Ebola virus can transmit from the wild animal to the people, right? So it can be transmitted first of all from the wild animals to the people. You can say that the carrier of the Ebola virus are basically the chimpanzee, gorilla or fruit bats also. So they are the carriers. From them, right, the virus can be transmitted to the people, and there is also the human to human transmission also. That means after transmitting from animal to people, there is people to people transmission also there, right? That is the human to human transmission. Okay, now it was thought that the fruit bats, right, which belongs to, right, the pteropod family have basically, you know, the natural Ebola virus host, right? It was thought, but now it was also found that the chimpanzee and the gorilla are also the natural host for the Ebola virus. And now this Ebola virus can also transmit not only about the human to human contact, say feeding or touching or like that, it can also, you know, transmit through the sexual contact as well also between the humans, right? Okay. Next, if you see the health impact related to the Ebola virus disease, so here the average fatality that has been recorded, right, for the Ebola virus disease is around 50%. So almost out of 100% people, 50% people died because of the Ebola virus disease. Now the fatality rate also varied. For example, in the certain areas the fatality rate was 90%, and it was also from 25 to 90%. That means it depends on the treatment, it depends on the therapy that had been provided to the patients. The early supportive care would definitely reduce the fatality related to the Ebola virus disease. So here early supportive care like rehydration, symptomatic treatment and you know, other type of survival therapy can be given to the patients, and that can improve, right, or that can reduce the fatality rates, right, because of the Ebola virus disease. Okay, now till now there is no licensed treatment that is proven to neutralize the virus, but there are certain range of the therapies or drug therapies that are available, right, and certain other therapies which are under development for this purpose. Okay, here you can find out the political map of the Democratic Republic of Congo. Here you can see the capital, which is known as Kinshasa. So Democratic Republic of Congo is also known as you know, the simply you can say Congo. Okay, now it is a country in the Central Africa. You can see that it is the map of Africa, so it's a part of Central Africa. So it's a country of in the Central Africa, and if you see the area, right, area wise, it is the largest country in the sub-Saharan Africa. Okay, it's the second largest country in all of the Africa, and it is the 11th largest country in the world. Right, you can see the neighboring countries like Angola, Zambia, Burundi, Rwanda, Tanzania, Uganda, Sudan, right? Right, these are all basically the neighboring countries belongs to the Democratic Republic of Congo. Okay, next, the open API, right? API means API basically is, you know, basically which is also mandated for the application programming interface. So here the application programming interface and an open API have been incorporated by the government of India to resolve certain issues related to the COVID app. Now, as you know that the COVID app is basically is the government app, which is, you know, with the Ministry of the Health have been providing the COVID app facilities to the citizens of this country to vaccinate. Okay, so here the citizens need to register themselves with the COVID app for the vaccination related to the COVID-19. Okay, now various categories of the people have been invited, right, to register themselves under the specified categories for the vaccination schedule. And there, if you have seen the vaccine, if you have seen this COVID app, right, you can easily identify that there are certain, you know, facilities within the app that will provide you the availability of the slot, the availability of the day for vaccination, the vaccination schedule, right, as well as the hospitals which are basically empaneled for the purpose of the vaccination. So this COVID app will also provide you this information along with that. Okay, now it is definitely mandatory for the people to get registered themselves for the appointment for vaccination. That is compulsory. Without registration, right, you cannot get the vaccination or you cannot get the vaccine dose. So now the 18 years to 44 years, right, this category of the people have been invited for registering themselves, right, for the slot specifically for the vaccine that will be provided to them. So here the people are finding very, very difficult in terms of getting slot, in terms of getting that information, right? So with the aim of resolving this problems related to the fixing of the appointment, the National Health Authority, which is a nodal agency, right, under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, right, is managing, which is the app of, called COVID app, have opened an application programming interface, right? That is an basically an application programming interface. This is basically a, you know, a platform for the vaccine appointment for the public. Okay, now here an open API or application programming interface would be available, right? And that will basically provide the developers easy access to the proprietary software application, and so that it can also easily can be managed. Okay, you can also use, for example, the Google Maps API, right, that can integrate with your, you know, with your different applications like the travel portal or the food delivery options like you are using also, right, for example, Zomato or the Swiggy and everything, right, which are also connected with this API or application programming interface. So it's in the similar way, right, you're also using the UPI API, right? So different type of apps basically can have the, you know, ease in terms of the easy payment, ease in terms of the availability of those information, right, availability of those the outlets which are there, right, for example, in your with that application programming interface. So that will be useful for the developers as well as for the common citizens to get services done, right, on the right time, right, without any problem or without any hassle. So here the National Health Authority has allowed anyone to access a set of requirement that is needed to communicate as well as interact with the COVID platform. Okay, and this will basically enable the developers, right, to build a third party tool, right? This third party tool will definitely allow the users to set an alert, for example, if that particular slot is not available, right, and this is your requirement that you cannot come for other slot, right, it will set an alert that whenever, you know, you have the availability of that, you know, the slot, right, you will get alert right? Or you will get basically some sort of a information related to the slot is availability, right? At that point of the time. So the people can use this third party tool, which can basically, you know, can get related or can get the, you know, the supportive alert related to the availability of the slot. It is definitely, you know, after you enter yourself or after you register yourself with your details, that will be provided with the help of this application programming interface. Okay, so this is basically how this COVID app would looks like once you enter or once you download it from your basically your Google Play Store. All right, next, RTS-S. So RTS-S is basically a new malaria vaccine candidate. So simple, you can say it is a new malaria vaccine, right, which has shown, right, the high efficacy, that is 77%. So in the trials, in the phase 2B trials, right, which was conducted by the scientists, this new malaria vaccine candidate has shown the higher range of efficacy, that is 77%, right? And this study is basically published in the preprints with the Lancet Journal. Okay, so this new vaccine candidate, which is also known as RTS-S, it is also known as R21 Matrix M. It is a simplified modified version of RTS-S, which was the previous candidate or another candidate or another vaccine that have been in the development for more than 30 years. Okay, so a new vaccine candidate or the new variant of this older version, that is RTS-S, right, have been produced, right? Now that has, you know, in the development, in the, that is there for the 30 years, and that was basically with the help of various research institutions, like you have the Walter Reed Institute of Research, okay? Second is GlaxoSmithKline and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, along with the PATH Malaria Vaccine Initiative, right? So this all organizations are basically working for the development of this malaria vaccines. Okay, the previous version of this vaccine candidate known as RTS-S, right, have not been sufficiently shown, right, the efficacy with respect to the malaria. Now, the new vaccine candidate R21 or Matrix M is developed, right? This has shown, right, the higher range of efficacy specifically to control this malaria, right? Malaria specifically from certain tropical countries. Okay. Now let us understand some of these institutes, like Walter Reed Institute of Research. So this Walter Reed Institute of Research is basically, it's the largest biomedical research facility. It is administered by the US Department of Defense. Okay. Regarding the Bill and the Melinda Gates Foundation. See, Bill and the Melinda Gates Foundation is simply in a non-profit agency, which is basically fighting for the poverty, for the disease and inequality in the society, right? And it is simply committing to tackling the greatest inequity in the world that is there, okay? And GlaxoSmithKline, the GlaxoSmithKline basically is a British multinational pharmaceutical company, okay? It has been headquartered as the Brentford in England, okay? And regarding the PATH Malaria Vaccine Initiative, the PATH Malaria Vaccine Initiative is simply a program of the PATH. It's a program of PATH. So what is this PATH? This PATH is basically an international non-profit organization, right, that drives for, you know, for transformating innovative or innovation to save the lives and improve the health, specifically among the children, among the women. Okay. So this, you can say that, this organization basically working with the private industry, with the government support or with the academia, the ultimate purpose is to develop the malaria vaccine, right? So this PATH Malaria Initiative is basically an initiative from the PATH, which is nothing but an international non-profit organization, which main aim is to develop the malaria related vaccines, right, in order to eliminate the malaria from the world. Okay, next. The vaccine is designed to stop the Plasmodium falciparum, right, which is a malaria parasite, from entering the liver, right? Once this Plasmodium falciparum enters into the liver, that basically causes the deadly blood stages, and that basically causes some other complications in the body. Okay, now you can also say that it targets the liver stage protein of the Plasmodium falciparum life cycle. This Plasmodium falciparum life cycle, right, is more important to be attacked, otherwise it can cause certain other complications. All right, so what is that Plasmodium falciparum? Plasmodium falciparum is basically a unicellular protozoan parasite of humans, okay, and it is the deadliest species of Plasmodium that causes the malaria in the humans. So I would again repeat, the Plasmodium falciparum is basically a unicellular protozoan parasite of humans, and it is the deadliest species of Plasmodium that can cause the malaria in the humans. Now, this parasite, right, is basically is transmitted through a bite of, right, a female Anopheles mosquito, right, and it basically causes, the disease most dangerous form, that is simply called as the falciparum malaria, and it is basically having the high amount of fatality. Okay, now 30 years down the line, right, this vaccine candidate, which is known as RTS,S is the first and to date the only vaccine, right, which is available to reduce the malaria in the children. But that vaccine is still not highly efficacious. That vaccine does not have high efficacy to control, the malaria specifically in the children's. And what we need is basically is the new vaccine candidate, right, which is basically, control this malaria specifically in, in the some of the tropical countries, because this malaria problem is basically more rampant in the tropical countries. Okay, now to control this epidemic, that is, as I told you, the previous version or the new version of this candidate known as R21 Matrix M have been identified, and this version have the high efficacy, that is around 77%, specifically to control the malaria among the children and the women. Okay, so this will definitely reduce the malaria burden specifically among the children and the women, specifically in the tropical countries. Okay, so this new version called R21 Matrix M have been developed with the help of the University of the Oxford. It's a similar university, right, it's a similar location where the COVID-19 vaccine known as AstraZeneca was developed. Okay, now the scientists are working on this version called R21 Matrix M at least for 6 to 7 years now, right, and they have got this success in the form of R21 Matrix M, right, and this vaccine which was produced is basically, by Serum Institute of India. Okay, the Serum Institute of India, all of you probably knowing, is also producing the vaccine related to the COVID also. For example, the Serum Institute of India is basically the Indian biotechnology and the pharmaceuticals company. Okay, and you can say that it is the world largest vaccine manufacturer. It is the world largest vaccine manufacturer, and it is located in the Pune city, which is a district in Maharashtra, right? And it is founded by the Cyrus Poonawalla, right? Cyrus Poonawalla was basically an industrialist, right, in 1966. And this company is basically subsidiary of the holding company called Poonawalla Investment and Industries. Okay, I think this is sufficient for the Serum Institute of India. Okay, next, the production linked incentive scheme for the food processing industry. As you know that, simply the by name itself suggests that production linked incentive, that means the government is providing certain incentives related to the production, right, so that the food processing industries can grow in the country, so that any sort of opportunities related to the export or export potential related to the food processing industries can be harnessed. So government is proposing certain incentives related to this production of the food processing industries, right? So here the Ministry of Food Processing and the Industries have brought certain operational scheme guidelines, right, which was basically launched online in the online portal for the purpose of providing the incentive specifically for food processing industries, so that their potential can be harnessed over the period of the time. So it is basically on the lines with the Prime Minister announcement of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, okay, which was basically announced by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, right? And this is basically has been approved as a central sector scheme, namely the production linked incentive scheme for the food processing industry. And that scheme would be the central sector scheme, and that would be, you know, implemented from 2021-22 to 2026-27. That means around, you can say around 7 years that scheme would be implemented, and that will have the outlay of around 10,900 crore rupees. Regarding Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, everybody would have understood or listen at least this Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. So it is basically translate, or you can basically understood the Atmanirbhar Bharat in terms of the self-reliant India. Self-reliant India, right? The Atmanirbhar Bharat is simply, you can say, the Hindi word of self-reliant India. It was popularized by Prime Minister Narendra Modi himself, right? In relation to the COVID pandemic, right? Specifically, you know, when the Prime Minister Narendra Modi was basically proposing, right, a special economic and a comprehensive package of around 20 lakh crore rupees, right? That is roughly, you can say, around 10% of India's GDP. Specifically to fight the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, the main purpose is basically, you know, to make India a bigger and more important part of global economy, right? And also to pursue certain policies that are efficient, that are competitive, that are resilient, right? As well as that are being self-sustaining and self-generating in the nature. So that are all encompassing basically your Atmanirbhar Bharat. And you know, the government basically have taken several reforms, right, specifically in the every sector under this, you know, the Atmanirbhar Bharat. So you can say that the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also outlined at that point of the time the five pillars of this Atmanirbhar Bharat. That is the economy, first pillar; second, infrastructure; third pillar, system; fourth pillar is vibrant economy; and the fifth pillar is demand. So the five pillar of this Atmanirbhar Bharat, which was himself given by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, are economy, infrastructure, system, vibrant demography, and your demand, right? Fine. So the objective of this providing this incentive to those food processing industries is to make, right, you know, the global food manufacturing champions, specifically on the lines with the India's natural resource endowment. So India have a lot of natural resources that can also be used in terms of the food processing, and so that the government can support the India's brand, right, specifically the food products in the international market. So here the Ministry of Food Processing and the Industry is inviting the applications specifically for availing certain benefits or certain incentives related to, you know, under the scheme. So here the incentives or the grants will be providing for branding, for marketing activities, right, related to, you know, certain food processing products, right, under the scheme. And these products are under categorized as under three categories for the purpose of, you know, providing the incentives, right, for the purpose of food processing. So here the three categories: category one, so here you can have the large entities, right, that can apply for certain incentive that is based on the sales and the investment criteria, right? For example, if the sales for particular the product is for them, say, for example, greater than the particular threshold, or the investment is greater than particular threshold, you will be provided the incentive for the purpose. The ultimate idea of providing this type of incentive for the, on the basis of the sales or investment criteria, is simply to have you know, the higher, you know, diversification in terms of the food processing, because India is lagging behind this in the food processing sector. So idea is to tap the potential of the natural resources that we have in terms of the food processing. Okay, so here, right, the applicants under this category could undertake the branding and the marketing activities specifically for those products. Okay, the category seconds, here the small and the medium industries, that is SMEs. So small and medium industry basically can apply for that, right? For example, for their innovative and organic products, right? And they can apply for the production linked incentive based on the sales. Okay, and under the third categories, they can basically solely apply for the grant for undertaking the branding or marketing activities, that is abroad. Okay, so all three categories can be applied for this incentives, right, which will be based on the food processing products. Okay, next, the integrated goods and service tax, that is also called IGST. Now you must understand that because of the COVID pandemic, right, what is happening is that the India is facing the shortage of the medical oxygens, right, certain supportive the medical instruments, right? And the because of this severe shortage, government of India has now waived off this integrated goods and service tax, right? The integrated goods and service tax basically is applied when the basically certain items or certain products basically move, right, in the interstate travel. So that means from Rajasthan to Madhya Pradesh, if certain products basically move, it will be applied with the integrated goods and service tax. So now center has decided to waive this integrated goods and service tax, specifically only those products which are on the imported or which are imported. And these products are basically related to the medical supplies of oxygen, right, which are related to the medical oxygen, the medical drugs like the remdesivir injection or the oxygen concentrators or the cryogenic tanks or any sort of a COVID vaccine. It is specifically related to the COVID related medical supplies only. Okay, so for that purpose, the IGST or integrated goods and service tax have been waived off. Okay, now this exemption or this waiving of this IGST is only applicable till 30th June. Okay, and here that supplies would be for free distribution for the medical supplies. And earlier, you know, the center has already waived off certain the import duty or health cess, which was also there on the medical supplies. So now government is forced to waive off these import duty or integrated goods and service tax because there are the huge shortage, and it's a simple negligence by a part of the government, right? They have not proactively or have taken the steps to have enough amount of this, you know, the COVID related medical supplies, right, in the stock. Right now the people are dying because of their absence, right? Okay, so here I told you that integrated goods and service tax, that is IGST, is simply meaning integrated goods and service tax, and it is applied, right, as a part of the GST or goods and service tax. So it's a part of the goods and service tax. First of all, the goods and service tax consisting of the three type of tax, that is CGST means central goods and service tax, IGST that means integrated goods and service tax, SGST means state goods and service tax. Okay, now it is basically, you know, the concept that is one tax, one nation. And the IGST falls under the Integrated Goods and Service Tax Act 2016. Okay. And the IGST or Integrated Goods and Service Tax, as I told you, is applicable only when there is the movement of the goods or the services from one state to the another state, right? So if there is a movement, definitely at that movement, that is interstate movement, you can say that only during interstate movement, okay, the IGST is applied. The IGST is applied, right, on those products or on those services, right? So here about IGST. So IGST is basically definitely a tax, right, which will generate a revenue. And now this revenue would be shared, right, by the state government, right, and by the central government as per the rates which are fixed by the authority, right? So here for the purpose of fixing of these rates, what we have set up is Goods and Service Tax Council. So that is called GST Council. The GST Council have been set up for the purpose of fixing of these rates, right? Based on their rates, the revenue that is generated out of IGST will be shared among the central government and the state government. So that is basically governed under Article 369A of the Indian Constitution. So for that, if you have read this article that was basically added newly after amending the Constitution, so GST, which will apply on the course of interstate trade, right, that is basically under IGST, right, that will be levied and collected by the government of India. So first of all, the IGST levy means who can impose. So only the government of India has the power to impose this IGST. The state cannot impose. Second, who can collect it? Only the central government can only, you know, collect this IGST. So here the GST, which is applied on the course of interstate trade, that is simply IGST, will be levied and will be collected only by the government of India and their agencies. Now such tax, once they are collected, right, shall be apportioned or shall be distributed between the union and the states according to the law, that is on the recommendation of Goods and Service Tax Council. So very simple, for example, if this is a boundary and there is a movement of the goods, for example, this is a state one and it is a state two. Definitely, with that movement, the one state may claim another, you know, higher revenue, right? For example, this state, they are passing off some goods from this state to another state. This state say that, no, this I will impose more tax on this part of your product. This state says that, no, I will impose more. Both of these states basically started claiming the more revenues. Now, what will happen? There will be definitely, you know, there will be problem in the movement of the goods and the services. So, what to remove that problem, the center has, or the constitution has mandated that such type of movement of the goods and the services, which is basically falling under interstate movement or interstate trade, only the central government has power to levy, right, such tax, and central government can basically collect those taxes or those revenues, and later it can be distributed. It can be distributed between the union and the states, so that any sort of interstate movement or any sort of interstate trade and commerce can be smoothened, can be harmonized, right, within the Union of India. Okay. So under the IGST scheme, right, 50% of the collection will go to the center, that is fixed under goods and service tax, you know, component. And remaining 50% will be allocated to the states and the union territories. That is, you know, IGST scheme has been provided this type of allocation, that 50% will go to the center and remaining 50% will go to basically your the union territories as well as your states. So this is goods and service tax. You can say that if the selling of the products and the services is falling within the state, within the same state, then you may impose the two types of taxes, that is central GST or state GST. If there is an interstate sale or interstate movement of the goods and services, you can have the integrated goods and service tax, right, that I have explained to you. Okay. Next, Jagmohan. See, Jagmohan was basically, you know, a former union minister, or who was also the former governor of Jammu and Kashmir. He recently passed away at the age of 94. Okay. His full name was Jagmohan Malhotra. He was born in 1927. He died in 2021. Okay. He was also the former Indian civil servant. And he was basically also the politician, belongs to the Bharatiya Janata Party. Okay. And regarding his service or regarding his, you know, his contribution, he was also the vice chairperson of the Delhi Development Authority or DDA. Okay. In 1970s. And he was also contributed specifically in the formulation and implementation of the Delhi Master Plan for the purpose of the development of Delhi. And he was also the most important figure specifically in the role of planning and implementation of the projects in Delhi under the Delhi Master Plan, right? And he was later also become the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi and the Goa, and he was also the fifth governor of Jammu and Kashmir. Okay. And he was nominated to the Rajya Sabha as a MP, and he was also, right, represented the New Delhi in the Lok Sabha twice. That means he was the MP specifically in the Lok Sabha, right, that is directly elected member, right, specifically from the New Delhi constituency. And at the time of Atal Bihari Vajpayee cabinet, right, he was also served as the Union Minister for the Communications, Urban Development, Tourism and the Culture. And he was later awarded as the Padam Shri, Padam Bhushan and Padam Vibhushan, right, which are basically the award which are given to the civilians, right, for the purpose of their outstanding contribution. So he is basically Mr. Jagmohan, who has recently been passed away. Okay. Next, the Asian Development Bank. As you know, the Asian Development Bank is the most important bank that provides the loans and other funding mechanisms to the countries. Now, there is, you know, an annual meeting for the Asian Development Bank. So Asian Development Bank's annual meeting 2021 is being held, right? So here, you know, this a part of annual meeting, the governors or the governor of, governor for India from the Asian Development Bank, who is also the Union Minister for the Finance and the Corporate Affairs, Miss Nirmala Sitharaman, have been participating in the seminar, which was also related to the Asian Development Bank, right? The seminar has titled as the Cooperation for Resilient Future. Okay. Now, regarding this Asian Development Bank, the Asian Development Bank was basically conceived way back in 1960s. It was conceived, right, as a part of the ministerial conference that was held, right, on the economic cooperation for the Asia, right, that was held by the United Nations Economic Commission for Asia and the Far East in 1963. And this institution called Asian Development was ultimately opened in 1966. at Manila, right, which is also capital of Philippines, right? And at the time of opening of Asian Development Bank, the 31 members were basically the founding members, right? The initial member that were basically joined. Okay. And currently it has 67 members. That is, out of, you know, 67 members, 31 members were basically the founding members. And India was basically one of the founding members at the time of formation of this Asian Development Bank in 1966. And out of 67 members, 48 members are basically from within Asia and Asia and the Pacific, and remaining 19 members are basically outside of Asia and Pacific. Okay. What are the objectives? Simply, it is basically a financial institution. The objective of the financial institution is basically to provide, right, certain avenues for the development of the economic growth and cooperation, specifically right to the poorest regions of the world, and to that is financial institution that is basically the Asian in the character. So you can say it is a multinational or multilateral development financial institution that provides the loans and the technical assistance and the grants to the countries, right? How it is working? The working of the Asian Development Bank is basically similarly with the World Bank, or it has been modeled closely on the World Bank, right? For example, regarding you know, the voting system, right? It is also having the vote, the weighted voting system, where the voting pattern to the members are basically given in proportion to their capital subscriptions, right? As it was there, or it is there in the case of World Bank. Okay, if you see the voting, you know, if you see the proportion of the share, right, on 31st December 2016, the Japan and the United States hold the largest proportion of the share, that is 15.607%, and the second highest share is basically held by the China, that is 6.444%. The third highest share is held by the India, that is 6.331%, and the fourth is basically your Australia, that is 5.786. And currently the Asian Development Bank is official United Nations observer, right, in the case of United Nations. So here you can see the Asian Development Bank is located in the Manila, which is also the capital of Philippines. Okay, next, the non-basmati rice exports. See, non-basmati rice exports have been now grown recently. Now India has achieved this export of the non-basmati rice from the Paradip port, right? Paradip port is basically a major port of the coast of Odisha. So this export of the non-basmati rice have been exported to the Vietnam recently, right? So it is a major boost definitely to the India's rice export, right? Definitely to, you know, specifically from the eastern coast of Paradip coast of the coast of Odisha. And this consignment, which is basically, you know, related to the non-basmati rice, have been basically, you know, flagged off from the Paradip coast or Paradip International Cargo Terminal, that is off the coast of Odisha to the Vietnam. Now, this is the first time that the Paradip port is basically exporting the non-basmati rice. And now the 20 containers of the rice, right, which is basically, you know, shipped, right, and that will be basically followed by around 500 containers over the next 3 months, right, that will be shipped or that will be exported by this Sarala Food Group. This Sarala Food Group is exporting these consignments or the containers from the Paradip International Cargo Terminal of the coast of Odisha to the Vietnam. Okay. Now, regarding their consignment, this consignment is one of the agriculture, you know, processed food products export development authorities member exporter. That is Miss Sarala Food, right? So Miss Sarala Food is basically the APIDA's member exporter, right, who is eligible to export under the APIDA, right, which is basically, you know, I'll come to that, what is APIDA. There it will be shipping, right, to the Hai Phong port, which is lying in the Vietnam. Okay, and this non-basmati rice export specifically to the Asian countries, to the African countries, are undertaking, right, from the various ports across the country. For example, Kakinada coast, Visakhapatnam coast, Chennai coast, right, the Mundra port, and as well as your Krishnapatnam port is also one of the important ports that have been also associated with the export of this non-basmati rice. And Paradip coast will soon emerge as the largest or one of the largest major rice exporting port in the country, specifically, right, for the purpose of the non-basmati rice. Okay, regarding the agriculture, Agricultural and Processing Food Products and Export Development Authority or APIDA. So APIDA is basically established by the Government of India under the APIDA Act, which has been passed by the government of passed by the Parliament in 1985. You can simply say that it is an export, it is an APEX export trade promotion agency lies with the Government of India or set up by the Government of India. Okay. Next, the Devu Chaudhary. Who is Devu Chaudhary? The Devu Chaudhary was basically the renowned sitar player, right? Who was recently died because of COVID. Okay. Now he was basically the renowned sitarist and the teacher who was born in 1935 and he died in 2021. Now he is considered the greatest player, right, in the era of Ustad Vilayat Khan, right, in the era of Ravi Shankar or the Nikhil Banerjee. And he was also regarded as one of the leading proponents, okay, of the Senia style or Senia Gharana. So what is that Senia Gharana? See, Senia Gharana is basically, you know, is related to the Tansen, that is the father of Indian classical music. So you can say that this Gharana or this style is basically a style of music. The followers of this Tansen school of music are widely known as the followers of Senia Gharana, or you can say the Senia style. So he was also associated with the Senia style here itself. Okay. Regarding Ustad Vilayat Khan, so Ustad Vilayat Khan is basically, you know, is an Indian classical sitar player, right? And he is credited with the creation and the development of the Gayaki Ang, that is basically an you know, a mimic the sound of the human voice on the sitar. Okay. Next, the Ravi Shankar. Ravi Shankar is basically often is also known as the title Pandit, or he was also the Indian sitar virtuoso or composer, and he is basically one of the world best known exponent specifically of the Northern Indian classical music, and he was also very famous in the second half of the 20th century, and he has also influenced many such musicians throughout the world because of his contribution that has been given specifically to the Northern Indian classical music. Okay. And you know, the Devu Chaudhary has created the 8 new ragas, that is Vishveshwari, Palasarang, or you know, Anrudjani, you know, Ashiki Lait, then Swanadeshwari, Kalyani Bilabul, right, Shimanzari, then Prabhati Manzari, right. These all ragas was created by the Devu Chaudhary in the memory of his wife Manzu, right. And he was also authored the 3 books, that is specifically on the Indian music, that basically named as The Sitar and Its Techniques, The Music of India, and On Indian Music. These are the 3 books that were basically written by him. And he was basically the disciple of the most famous, the Mushtaq Ali Khan. And he started basically an academy or the center for the culture in the memory of his guru, that is Mushtaq Ali Khan, that is Umak. Umak means the Ustad Mushtaq Ali Khan Center for the Culture. That is the full name of the Umak that was started by, you know, by the Devu Chaudhary in the memory of his guru Ustad Mushtaq Ali Khan. And later the Devu Chaudhary was also conferred the Padam Bhushan and the Padam Shri Awards by the Government of India for his outstanding contribution specifically in the case of the Indian music. Alright. So he is basically the Devu Chaudhary. He was recently died of COVID-19 pandemic. Right. Next, the POX 186. See, POX 186 is basically, you know, basically a cloud or a galaxy that was basically, you know, found by the astrophysicist who basically using this Gemini telescope to find out this galaxy, which is known as POX 186. Now they have found out through this Gemini telescope that hydrogen clouds have been stripped off, right, from this basically, you know, the galaxy, and which is exposing this high energy light, right, which is also one of the most important contributions by the astrophysicists using this Gemini telescope. So here this contribution would definitely give you a clue regarding the puzzle of the reionization of the universe. Okay, so scientists are still working on the process called reionization and the process called and the mechanism of reionization. The process called reionization specifically is related to the Big Bang theory, and the reionization is a process that is, you know, that caused the matter in the universe to reionize, that is after the lapse of the dark ages, right? The reionization is the second of the two major phase transition of the gas, specifically in the universe. After the first such transition was recombination. Okay, so here the galaxy which is known as Pox 186 is so small that it can also fit inside the Milky Way. Okay, and the researchers who are working with the Gemini telescope to find out this galaxy called Pox 186 is also says that it is a compact size, and it is basically coupled with a very, very large population of the stars that can basically amount to 100,000 times of the mass of the sun, right? That can basically make the blow away possible related to this galaxy. Okay, related to the galaxy, so galaxy is basically a gravitational bound system of the stars or stellar remnants, or you can say they are part of the interstellar gas, dust, or the dark matter, right? So the word galaxy that you can say that is basically a Greek term, or simply the Greek term called galaxias, right? From there galaxy have been taken. Okay, regarding Gemini observatory, the Gemini observatory is basically an astronomical observatory that is consisting of a telescope that is 2 8.1 meter telescopes, right? Which is basically also known as the Gemini North and Gemini South. Okay, now they are located basically at the two separate sites. The one Gemini North is located in the Hawaii, and second the Gemini South is located in the Chile, respectively. Okay, this Gemini telescope or this Gemini observatory is basically provide the complete coverage of the northern and the southern sky. Specifically, see, the Hawaii is located in the northern part of hemisphere, and the Chile is located in the southern part of hemisphere. So definitely the Gemini North will provide the complete coverage of the skies of the northern part or northern hemisphere, and the Chile, which is located specifically in the basically the southern America, right, that will provide the complete coverage of the southern hemisphere, specifically in the southern hemisphere, in the southern sky, right? And it is currently the most largest and most advanced the optical telescopes which are available to the astronomers in the world. Okay, so here you can have this Pox 186, right? That is the galaxy which is named by the scientist. All right, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow. So today's lecture was a bit lengthy, so I'll try to compact it. Okay, so let's enjoy and have all precautions and the safety from your basically COVID pandemic. So all the best, and we'll meet again tomorrow for our next.